Many believe magic has maintained order in Quel'Thalas. My bow would say otherwise. One shot, one kill. This is how I preserve our realm. I am Illyria Windrunner. If you stand against me, you're just another target. And I never miss my mark.
Welcome back, everybody, to the Winter Preliminaries for the America's Championship. My name is Frodan, and I'm on the desk with Brian Kibler, as well as Kevin, one of the newcomers to the caster desk. Kevin, you had a great day number one, and that first match was pretty exciting. What do you think about it so far?
I think day two has been awesome so far, Dan, and I'm really excited to see all the players who are going to be advancing to the Winter Championships next month. There's some really high-level players, and we've got to see a lot of really impressive games over the course of the first day. So now we know a little bit more about these players, about the lineups they've brought, and I think we're in for a real treat in this next one.
All right. Well, coming up, we have Owl Sky High versus Fibonacci, a player that is well-storied within the professional players, but not necessarily within the people watching. But I think by now, his name has become mysterious enough that we're familiar with him, aren't we, Kibler?
Yeah, I mean, Fibonacci coming into this event was a player who really didn't have much in the way of tournament results, but was kind of a mythical legend ladder player. He got number one ranked legend many, many times, and was particularly notorious for his warrior play, and we see he is, of course, playing that here today.
And we have access to that warrior. You know, one of the things that people were doing was banning the warrior from Fibonacci, whether out of respect or out of fear or out of the actual preparation. Who knows? But the point is, it was getting banned very regularly. However, this series, it seems like Sky High is choosing to ban the Druid instead. Fibonacci is taking his opponent's warrior out of the equation, most likely because we know he has cards or decks like Freeze Mage in his lineup, which would be a very hard obstacle to overcome.
Yeah, we actually saw Fibonacci's reputation, I think, maybe give him a bit of an edge in the first match we streamed yesterday, where his opponent banned away his warrior out of respect for his reputation, but ended up suffering when his mid-range Paladin deck couldn't find a win against the Freeze Mage.
Yeah, that's right. And if that ends up becoming a thing for him, that's another added strength. And honestly, that kind of mystique is a little bit missing in Hearthstone these days, if we have to be completely honest with ourselves. Not too many players are known for one deck, because in Conquest, you have to be very good at a lot of decks. You have to spread out your knowledge and be more good at breadth. But Fibonacci is absurdly deep with his Control Warrior knowledge, which makes it very rich. And people love that experience, because when Control Warrior is poor in the metagame, when Druid's on top, Control Warrior should be at its weakest. Not to mention there's also Paladins out there that makes the matchup very hard. So what makes him so successful, do you think, Kevin, when you see Fibonacci's play? What's the secret?
I mean, Fibonacci is one of those players who, more so than anybody, and especially because he's so well known for his ladder play, really shows up with very smart technical choices in how he constructs his deck. He's one of the very few players who I think really knows the ins and outs of how to choose the right cards for the right opportunities when he is in a meta that, in theory, is going to be really difficult for Warrior as a whole. And I'm really excited to see his Warrior deck in play today. I'm also really excited because, let's be honest, he's Canadian.
That is something to root for, because we have a lot of American players. We have a couple people from Latin America as well. Kuglorin is still in that lower bracket. We'll see him later. But for now, we'll see whether or not Fibonacci can continue to go through, or will yet another Dark Horse who we're not anticipating be able to upset one of the players that we're expecting to win.
What I'm excited to see here is for Fibonacci to draw his golden coin with his Control Warrior deck. No, it's regular. It's a regular. I'm so disappointed. Oh, Fibonacci, the warrior god, doesn't even have his full gold deck.
One non-golden card, but the rest of them very shiny.
I wonder what it is.
Rumors have it, right, that if you have an entire deck of 30 golden cards, you should get the golden coin. And it is often a joke, because the warrior deck has a lot of heavy legendary minions.
Exactly.
At the very top ends, you have big Dr. Booms and Grommash Hellscreams and even Baron Geddens. Already some interesting choices included into the mix.
And there's an interesting choice, certainly Deathwing, drawn by Fibonacci. That was a card that was a very distinctive inclusion in the Control Warrior deck he played to number one legend in the December season, alongside Tournament Medic, of all things.
Yeah, and he's seen a lot of success with that deck list. But you are seeing...
There's the culprit. The non-Golden Doomsayer.
You're right.
The non-Golden Doomsayer. There had to be one. There had to be one. You are seeing as well, though, Sky High does have some good answers to this deck already. We're seeing Harrison Jones and that big game hunter out in his hand already. So this is going to be probably a longer game as these two can ask and answer each other's questions.
Yeah, the Control Warlock versus Control Warrior, whatever version of Control Warlock it is, it is a matchup that has been pretty debated throughout sort of the history of competitive Hearthstone. I know that Life Coach, was someone who claimed that Handlock had an enormous edge over Control Warrior, and it's we see the main reason for that, of course, is the Warlock hero power, the ability to just eventually bury your opponent under threats. But that doesn't necessarily take into account cards like Doomsayer, cards like Deathwing. So it'll be interesting to see how this plays out.
Yeah, I'll have to imagine because of cards like Deathlord, it makes the matchup more difficult for the Warrior than necessary if it ends up having to pull a big minion like a Dr. Boom off the top. But it is manageable. We do see Shio Sam in a lot of armor. It's one of those scenarios, too, where Boom doesn't get the Boom boss. So maybe you're happy to see it actually come out that way.
I don't know if you're really happy to see Dr. Boom come down off of the Deathlord. It still means you do have to expend a Shield Slam for really no investment from your opponent. He loses the Dr. Boom out of his deck, but still the same number of cards in hand, but still able to spend the full amount of mana the previous turn.
Yeah, in general, right, that's a draw that isn't hard for him to answer, but it is still a big threat. It is still something that does remove one of his very limited removal choices, because as he's teched this deck for a lot of very specific things to try to control the board, right? The Doomsayers, the Deathlords, he does have a very limited suite of cards left to him to get rid of the big threats in the later game. Mm-hmm.
I suppose one card you wouldn't be upset to be pulled would be Reno Jackson, because that is what the deck is oriented around, that large heal, but we do see it in hand, which is also gives a lot of ability to rebound off of life tapping excessively in this game.
One of the really key cards in this matchup, we actually see in All Sky High's hand, that Jiraxxus. This is a matchup that typically goes very late and is very much oriented around both players exhausting their resources. And Jiraxxus, with the hero power to create an Infernal every turn, can really bring the game out of reach in the long term for the Control Warrior. And this is a match that is very long term.
It's interesting to see Sky High throw down that Doomsayer now. He just doesn't want to see his opponent get any more work done. And I guess maybe he's looking at wanting to take and get some of his control back on his side of the board.
Or just Jiraxxus straight up.
Yeah, this lets him be guaranteed, essentially, a board where his opponent has nothing in play and is able to play Jiraxxus. And I think that's a very heads-up play from All Sky High here. We were just saying that Jiraxxus is a very key card here. And what you need to be worried about with Jiraxxus is potentially running into your opponent just be able to kill you from 15. Because no matter how much healing you have, you only have 15 life. This is an interesting choice from Fibonacci. We see a Jeweled Scarab.
Yeah, Warrior does not immediately jump out as a class with a lot of great 3-mana cards. Mm-hmm. Usually with Jeweled Scarab, you want to make sure that you can curve out very good with it. Shaman, for example, has access to a lot of great 3-mana cards.
I'd be curious to see if perhaps Fibonacci actually has Reno of his own. I don't generally like Reno in these decks, but seeing a lot of somewhat strange individual card choices like that Scarab, we do see the Deathwing, the Doomsayer. We did see two copies of Shield Slam and two copies of Shield Maiden. But those are cards that are pretty high value to Control Warrior, and because your games do go so long, you can afford often to wait to draw some of your doubles. So it's a possibility.
Both these decks are teched really smart, too. Like, they've looked at all the different potential matchups that they might need to use these cards for. Fibonacci with Jeweled Scarab can reach for something maybe in terms of some type of mid-game armor removal, something as simple as a bash. And Sky High running this Kezan Mystic is really, really heads up in the current meta.
Yeah, we have seen lots of Freeze Mages. That's been one of the more popular decks that we have encountered throughout the weekend and throughout last week as well. I believe, generally speaking, many players looking to beat Secret Paladin decks where Freeze Mage is quite strong.
And the prevalence of Zoo Warlock as well, where Freeze has a really, really strong matchup.
Yeah, absolutely. So Fibonacci, he's in an interesting spot here. He does have the Shield Slam, going to take out the big taunt. Can Owl the other one to push some damage to the face. He's trying to build up a strong enough board that he can potentially threaten to win the game with that Grom in a single attack. No matter how much healing All Sky High does have, he, again, is only able to go back up to the total of 15 life because he now is Jiraxxus.
Yeah, therefore, cards like Reno Jackson lose a lot of significant power. But one thing that I do think that Sky High was evaluating was the strength of his hand. after Jiraxxus. Mm-hmm. That's also something that you have to take into account for. And when you have access to AoE removal, taunt minions, and even cards like Iron Beak Owl, which can help you deal with annoying threats, I think his decision to go Jiraxxus was even more smarter than we anticipated as well, given his hand context. And now that he's removing and he's going to be pretty safe outside of the range, I'm still feeling that Skyhigh's in a great position. Even though Fibonacci right now still does have some opportunities to win, I think that window's going to close very rapidly the longer this game goes.
Yeah, as all Skyhigh runs out of taunt minions, though, it does continue to open him up to the possibility of Fibonacci having some big burst damage with Grom. The biggest threat really is, you know, he's forced to use all those taunt givers because he's playing a Reno deck, probably only has a couple of them. So he in fact chooses to not play one this turn. So possibly he's looking at that [S2] Yeah. [S1] as a real threat.
We've also seen a lot of Skyhigh's really good answers to the late game minions that Fibonacci has. The Siphon Soul is already gone. He's just got the one big game hunter because he is running Reno Jackson. So in this style, Fibonacci's style of control warrior, he's got to make sure he has answers to all of the additional threats that are going to come down as this game progresses.
You know, there's some interesting synergies within Fibonacci's options. The fact that Doomsayer survives at the silence means that it can win a brawl. And the fact that the Brawl does leave one minion up means that Bouncing Blade can guarantee clear, so he's got some interesting combos.
There's a second Jeweled Scarab. Ooh, he just picks up a shield block, just I think it was a cycle, doesn't really care so much about the armor, but just wants to look for more options. And yeah, I think we're going to see this Brawl come out here, potentially clear his opponent's board off. And we see, you know, with all the Infernals that Skyhigh has created, Fibonacci just keeps having the ability to answer all of them. Is this Scarab wins in a fight?
What a
champion.
That
is one tough little beast.
And I would say that's the preferable option, because even if it's one damage, if he picks up Execute, that is a very valuable card. On Skyhigh's end, though, it's like you said, Kibler, one thing that we didn't talk about is the Reno deck doesn't have access to as many taunts as the traditional Handlock deck. You only have one copy of each. So at best, you have one Sludge Belcher, one Sunfire Protector, one Defender of Argus.
But this Bouncing Blade is excellent here. Wow. It's able to allow him to remove the remove the Emperor and get damage on the Infernal. And he just goes bash to the face. And we see here, he knows what he's doing. He's looking to either set up for Grom Burst or just getting that resource out of his hand because he wants to set up the ability to play the Deathwing without too much of a drawback.
Right. At some point, he wants to force out whatever is left for Skyhigh of his healing options. He wants to see Reno come down and know that there's nothing left for the Warlock player and be able to start and use his last remaining resources. He's going to hold this Deathwing right till the very end.
Yeah, that is a Grom enabler in the slam, but realizes, you know, just in a bad spot. Revenge also can enable the Grom Burst. But what we really are seeing here is just what we were talking about earlier in terms of the impact of Jiraxxus in the late game. Fibonacci, he has tons of armor, and he has used all these great removal options, but all Skyhigh just summons an Infernal every turn, and he's putting on so much threat. All that armor that Fibonacci has, all that life, it's not going to last very long.
Yes. At least for two or three more turns. That weapon is a very important draw, though.
Yeah, Death Spite is huge because it gives Fibonacci something in play that he can use to both get additional damage in as well as enable the Grom. But even with Death Spite plus Grom, he can only deal a total of 14 damage. He'd need a little bit more if all Skyhigh were to play that Reno Jackson and go back to full.
It depends on how safe he feels, because right now he's also going to put out a lot of damage. And it might be one of those convenient things where Revenge will be able to activate for 3 damage. Although realistically it might not as well. Wait, is that it?
That's going to be it. He didn't use the Reno. Deathbite is going to be enough. The activator
that,
here.
I am really surprised that he just left himself dead to that Grom there. He has so many tools in his hand. The taunt minion, the Reno, and Fibonacci just manages to take it down despite falling behind that Jiraxxus the entire game.
I think he really wanted to be afraid of the second Brawl. That is something that you know Fibonacci's accounting for. When you're playing Doomsayers, Death Lords, and even to the extent Scarabs to potentially pick up more Death Lords, you know, you really want to be safe against a lot of aggressive decks. So you have those things like 2 Brawls in a deck, which might be common. If so, he just doesn't want to overextend because you're always afraid of that second Brawl. If you play the Imp Gang boss and the Dark Peddler, your power decreases significantly. So that could be some of the things that he's worried about.
Yeah, it's hard for me to imagine that it wasn't a misstep there to just leave yourself dead Jiraxxus with so many ways to, or not Jiraxxus, to Grom as Jiraxxus when you have Reno in your hand. You know, Reno's a card that's not going to go increasing in value tremendously over the course of the game. You need to just keep yourself at that safe point. 10 is really the flash point that you want to be above, and he had the tools to do it.
Right, and he had seen Fibonacci hold those couple of cards, right? Mm-hmm. We knew they were Grom and Deathwing, but as the Warlock, you have to be constantly evaluating, is that the burst that he needs to end the game?
It felt like All Sky High was in a position where he just had to ask himself, man, how can I lose? And, this is...
Is it?
Yeah, he's going to overdraw a card.
He's going to overdraw a card. Wait, what?
Whoa. Well, there's a Defender Vargas. Not really key in this matchup. Though, amusingly, that Sacrificial Pact that All Sky High just drew, that's a potentially very powerful card if he does expect lots of other Warlock decks. It is clearly fantastic if your opponent becomes Jiraxxus and you're able to just kill them with a single card.
Yeah. There's a ton of tech cards in these decks. I'm really impressed at the range of stuff that Sky High is running.
Yeah, he has a lot of interesting choices, and he has so many cards in his hand that are so good against Freeze Mage. He has not only the Keys on Mystic, but also the Reno Jackson and the Lotheb, and even that Sacrificial Pact. That can be a big deal. Just giving yourself some options that can get you out of that burst range is just very, very powerful.
Right, with a demon on the board, if there is a freeze in play, choosing to sacrifice it and restore that health can be really, really important.
And here, this is the rarely seen beatdown Freeze Mage draw. Fibonacci just going to town with those mad scientists. He's actually done a ton of damage to All Sky High here, despite not actually casting any spells.
Can he force him to overdraw here again?
Yes, I believe so. And it looks like All Sky High, in fact, has exactly 8 cards in hand, so the Oracle will overdraw him. I don't know if there's necessarily any individual cards that would be a disaster if All Sky High loses, but...
Probably his Healbot would be very...
It would certainly be unfortunate, but it's less of an impact. Jiraxxus is a card you actually don't really want to play as the Warlock against Freeze Mage, because it does cap your life out at 15, and that puts you in very easy burst range.
I think this entire matchup is predicated on whether or not you can force your opponent to use cards like Reno Jackson before you play Alex Straza. Mm-hmm. So what you'll end up seeing a lot of these Freeze Mages do is use hero power to the opponent's face if they have a chance. But in this case, I believe Fibonacci's under too much board pressure that he might just Blizzard. Therefore, he's not going to get the chance to use that, and he's going to still look for opportunities to piece damage. One thing that is to consider is that he's running the Forgotten Torches over the Fireballs. Therefore, his deck does have extensive more damage than Fireball itself, and that does become relevant. The 3 extra damage that you gain can definitely put you over the edge, because most likely this game could go to fatigue, given that in the context that Reno Jackson just keeps being really defensive with its heals.
And he's going to be able to stay in the game for a long time here with that Kezzan Mystic. He now knows the additional secret in play is that Ice Block, and he can choose to take it pretty much at any time here.
It's interesting the timing of Kezzan Mystic against an opposing Ice Block. In a lot of cases, you'll want to wait until you'll have a turn where your opponent is relying on Ice Block to keep them alive. Then you not only take their Ice Block, but also kill them. And also, if you take the Ice Block in a turn that your opponent is not going to die, it gives them the opportunity to play another Ice Block, and then they still get the window of opportunity to keep themselves alive.
Part of what's scary, though, for Sky High is that he's already revealed the Kezzan Mystic from the previous game.
He used
Defender of Argus. So Fibonacci is on full notice. He's completely aware of what Sky High can do, including this Bronzebeard stealing both secrets. I'm not sure how relevant the Ice Barrier is, but he guarantees the Ice Block this way. Yeah. Now, the one thing is that you do have Lotheb in the hand. That is another big combination that you can use to try and lock it out. So Sky High going very aggressive here. We'll see if it pays off.
There's a ton of value there. Even if you don't actually get a chance to activate the Ice Barrier, taking it away from your opponent as something that they are technically relying on, and we've already seen both Mad Scientists die as well, so he has to play his second Ice Block from hand.
We see Fibonacci picks up the Doomsayer that can go with one of those Frost Novas in his hand. He was briefly debating pinging the Imp Gang boss in order to fill up his opponent's board so he couldn't play something like an Owl. Realized that he'd be a mana short here, though, so decides to just go ahead and play the Doomsayer instead.
That's right. There is opportunity for him to follow up this play. Say it does get silence, he has a Flame Strike, and that would be also a board clear. Mm-hmm. So Fibonacci doesn't have to go for stall turns. One of the things he considers, can I stall another turn, ping it, play Frost Nova number 1,
right,
then get value off number 2. But now he's getting a good read on his opponent's hand. That's a side
that's such a good top
that
deck.
That was a really fortunate draw for All Sky High here. He needed a way to keep this board alive. But Fibonacci does have the answer with that Flame Strike, and the ping will leave the board completely clear.
I think you also still have to get cracking on eventually the health pool here. Fibonacci controlling the board, completely reasonable. But again, you have to expect him to start going pinging to the face aggressively.
Yeah,
as well.
I mean, this is actually a really awkward situation for Fibonacci, because now that All Sky High has that that ice block, not only does it mean that, you know, Fibonacci does not, but Fibonacci needs to kill him and then very likely fight through Reno to kill him again. Mm-hmm. The Reno Jackson pairs extremely well with Ice Block because, oh, I go down to one life? Well, it's a great position to be in when you get rich.
And I don't think there's enough options available to the Freeze Mage player to kill a player from full twice.
He needs to actually enable a lot of fireballs off of Archmage Antonidas, I believe. He needs to set up a very big turn with that. And this is something that can help enable that. The Emperor getting a discount on a bunch of cheap spells like Frostbolt and Ice Lance. If Fibonacci finds the
Malygos.
He has Malygos in his deck, I believe, as well. Yes.
Yeah. That's the way you can kill from 25. Mm-hmm. The Frostbolt Ice Lance dream is to Frostbolt Ice Lance twice with Malygos, and I believe that's 25 damage. So it's like you can still definitely kill if you have an optimal Emperor. And I think Fibonacci, when he sees his opponent remove the Emperor this way, that's not what he was counting on. Five damage is still a little bit awkward for the Warlock to achieve, but Sky High burned two cards that aren't going to be that useful anyways. And this is for Sky High to protect himself against the Alexstrasza, which would set up the Malygos. But I think there's no pressure. You can even play your Loot Hoarder if you want to draw an additional card if you don't like it. He's just going to wait because he feels like he can take his time here.
Yeah, I think he wants to potentially force his opponent to react to that Loot Hoarder in some way. He does recognize that because of the Ice Block and the threat of Reno Jackson, he may need to get some amount of minion damage in. And we see All Sky High actually choose not to Life Tap here, which is an interesting decision. I wonder how much of that decision is based on fear of this matchup possibly going to fatigue, and how much of it is the recognition that perhaps he's afraid of just getting bursted down multiple times. But Alexstrasza does come down, and that life loss wouldn't have mattered.
Yeah. And we are at a point now where fatigue is a real threat, and the Lothab Big Game Hunter play here does protect him from really any follow-up from Fibonacci at this point. He is going to have now the full suite of tools available to him for the follow-up turn, but if this Ice Block gets popped, he's probably going to have a really hard time in any way staying in this game.
It's true, but I don't see a way for it to pop. When you see so many cards like Kazan Mystic and all those really weird things, like, I mean, we don't see Sacrificial Pact, but we see it, and therefore, I think it's safe to assume that he doesn't run the Arcane Golem Power of a Whelming Faces combination. That is one tech that we've seen these days. In fact, Hoi from Team Na'Vi climbed to rank number one EU Legend, I think, an hour ago with that deck. So that's probably a big key to success.
And there we see Ice Lance picked up by Fibonacci, which gives him even more burst potential with that Malygos. If he's able to break the ice block, he has the tools to potentially just kill his opponent very easily, despite the potential Reno. All right, Emperor for All Sky High, not super relevant here. He doesn't have a handful of things that are all that exciting to reduce.
Yikes.
Fibonacci, though, as we see, almost out of cards, he does have Forgotten Torch. We know that All Sky High has that ice barrier, so minion damage is going to be pretty unreliable here. He'd need to be able to get in at least 9 in order for it to matter at all. And here we see that he's just going to ping off his opponent's things. I wonder if he's actually just planning on fatigue, period.
Yeah, I think both players are very close to fatigue because of how aggressively Sky High has tapped. And I think Fibonacci is going to try to play as if this is a Freeze Mage mirror and say, I'm going to try to put you at a point where you die of fatigue so Ice Block doesn't matter for you.
And that's probably the best play he has available to him at this point, knowing that he is also at the point where he only has one card left to draw.
Yeah, there's two cards left in All Sky High's deck. Fibonacci with one card left in his.
Just Doomsayer, right?
Yes.
And that's why he didn't play the Loot Hoarder earlier, which makes complete sense given the context. I really like this play because there's almost no way you're going to force your opponent to play Reno Jackson. And Sky High is aware of this too, so he's trying to hold on to Reno Jackson. It's a very tense game right now.
Yeah, the dynamic here is really interesting. So both players sitting here. And now Fibonacci, can he do 17 exactly?
No, he can't.
That doesn't. Yeah. Ooh, Dr. Boom. That's interesting.
Yeah,
the death
rattles
his last
could
card.
Be a really, really big
deal
here.
The fact that the he does choose to go ahead and just reno himself back up to 30, fires off the Elven Archer. Here he wants to avoid the possibility of his opponent doing exactly what we were just talking about, getting him down to exactly that one life with the ice block.
He knows. I mean, that was such a good play from Sky High. Fibonacci didn't ping, so he says, if I didn't ping, Frostbolt Ice Lance with Malygos is 17 damage. Mm-hmm. I would have died. Really heads up play from Sky High, and Fibonacci now has to just go for it and really hope his opponent can't do 14 damage and put him into the game-ending decision.
Yeah, I'm trying to look at all the various flashpoints of math here with, what matters for what turns and as far as the fatigue goes. This is one of those places you actually just need an Excel spreadsheet open to be like, okay, this turn. It's kind of like doing like four horsemen back in original Naxx and WoW.
Sure.
This is going to be really awkward, and I mean, you have to think very carefully about all of the individual possibilities. Mm-hmm. Dr. Boom here is incredibly significant. Even the ability to play Dr. Boom, and if necessary, leave it on the board and trigger it using Hellfire later on. Like, there's so many little things that could be the way to trigger the ice block, get it out of play, push the additional damage.
I'm really trying to figure out how Fibonacci wins from this position, because clearly he's the one in a disadvantage right now.
Yeah, he needs to do exactly 20. Well, there's going to be a fatigue for two. So he needs to do 20 damage here. If he plays Malygos, Frostbolt, Ice Lance, I believe that's 17. So he's actually, and all of them is too much. And his opponent has the tools to actually get him down to a life total that will kill him this turn.
Right.
So I'm not really seeing a great window for Fibonacci to actually be able to win this.
That's why I was a little bit confused about the play for the Ice Lance the previous turn, but I think it's probably because Fibonacci was assuming that there was all spells remaining or situational cards like the Owl. I don't know if he was accounting for the Boom as the last card. Mm-hmm. And it's really hard to account for all 30 cards at one point of a Reno Jackson deck.
Yeah, in these games, you definitely need to be really heads up on exactly all of the tools that your opponent might have at their disposal. And it seems like this Dr. Boom may be something that was not accounted for by Fibonacci, and it may take him down.
I think he's also realizing if he plays Malygos, there's a very high chance your opponent's going to play a big removal on it. We see Twisting Nether, which means that Freeze Mage has no more damage, and this should be the final moments of the game coming down. An excellent game played by Sky High, I have to say.
Yeah, I thought that this game was really interestingly navigated by both players. And like you said, I would suspect we'll see the Boom Boss attack face, then Twisting Nether clear the board, leaving Fibonacci with a Loot Hoarder to try and win the game with, which is probably going to be pretty difficult.
Yeah, that would be extremely difficult, given that Fibonacci is almost dead next turn, because the Boom Bots, if it does 6 or 7 damage, I believe, it should be enough to kill Fibonacci on the following turn.
And even if it doesn't, there's no way out anymore for Fibonacci. He's got no resources left.
He's alive.
Not for long, though. He has the ability to Frostbolt himself. He found lethal, but
I would like
just
to
on the
ping
wrong side of the board.
I would like to ping my own
Loot Hoarder. Ping it.
Just for the style points. Or Frostbolt to show the 30th
exactly.
card.
You want to give your opponent as much information as possible, because then you have to play again. So we will see the match tied up at 1-1. So we saw some interesting moments in that game where the specific tech choices did very much come into play. The keys on Mystic, obviously a very big deal in that game. We saw the Cold Light Oracles managed to burn a couple of cards, but ultimately they didn't end up mattering.
Yeah, not significant in any way, although I have to say, if on style points alone, despite the fact that it didn't matter in any way to the outcome of the game, Bran into Kezzan Mystic was a pretty okay play.
That was pretty good. I definitely think the most important thing was keeping in track what his opponent could do. Mm-hmm. And this is where information is extremely relevant. The fact that Sky High knows that Fibonacci is playing the Malygos version of Freeze Mage makes all the difference in the world of why he chose to play Reno Jackson over drawing the 30th card Dr. Boom and not playing it. You know, you have to account for, okay, maybe he's trying to set up these burn things, but I know exactly his range. I played around it perfectly.
All right, well, this will be the mirror match between two Freeze Mage decks.
Oh,
and
man.
We're going to see some of the individual individual card choices in these players' decks. I think perhaps have a pretty big impact here.
Yes.
Specifically, the Cold Light Oracles in Fibonacci's deck are cards that I think, and I may be misevaluating here, but they seem to be chosen specifically for matchups that are likely to go to fatigue, because you don't draw more cards than your opponent ever. Whereas cards like the Novice Engineer, we see all Sky High play, things like the Acolyte of Pain, those are cards that can get you to fatigue much faster.
That's an interesting observation. I didn't really think about it that way, but you know, I was thinking more about the body with you associate with the draw, but that also makes a lot of sense in context of what you were talking about. In this matchup, it's highly relevant because Freeze Mage also is known to draw a lot, so you help them draw more, perhaps even burning. I think the key to this matchup is the fact that Fibonacci just has a dragon in his deck called Maligos. Freeze Mage has a really hard time removing big health minions, by noted of Ragnaros being one of the hardest counters to Freeze Mage. And Maligos also has more extended burst range because of the Emperor Thorsen with a bunch of burn cards like Ice Lance and Frostbolt. That gives you a huge advantage to this matchup. The only thing that's going for Sky High right now is that he has an Emperor Thorsen, but look at his hand. It's so awkward and pitiful. Cards like Frost Nova and Blizzard don't really do much this game. You might even use it on empty boards to just dump it.
Yeah, the other really interesting tech decision from Fibonacci is the inclusion of the Forgotten Torches and no Fireballs. And that is also another choice.
True.
That gives him further tools to play those sort of fatigue battles much better than his opponents.
Right, there's a smart interaction there with the Coldlight Oracles where, as you said, the draw is going to be perfectly even between the two players, but he's refilling his deck ever so slightly, which puts him at the tiniest of advantages if the game goes all the way to fatigue. Between the two players, Fibonacci has the slight advantage by virtue of Maligos, forcing Sky High to do a ton more math as far as when is he within range of being burst down.
Which seems appropriate when it's Fibonacci. There's a lot of math involved.
Oh, I understood that reference. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. That's
he's
right.
Also a math student.
I stayed awake for that
well,
lesson so. In algebra, Kibler. Thank you very much. A very good observation, too, made by Fibonacci in the previous turn, recognizing turn 6 is a very common Emperor Thorsen turn. So Sky High, I mean, he's using Arcane Intellect, which digs him deeper. He has cards like Acolyte Pain, which gets him very far into fatigue. I wouldn't be surprised to see Sky High hit fatigue 5 cards ahead of his opponent, giving him a very big disadvantage if it ends up dragging out that way. Now, there also is the other end of it. If Sky High finds an opportunity to play Alexstrasza very quickly, followed up with actual burn, which does exist in his hand, he could find himself in a position to be very offensive as opposed to dragging it out to the fatigue stages.
There is a definite opportunity here if Sky High can get a really, really critical Emperor Thorsen turn off, or if there's any possible way of him actually protecting Emperor Thorsen and keeping him alive for more than one turn, he does have some real opportunity here to set up just enough burst to be able to close the game out before Fibonacci can react.
Yeah, this is actually kind of an awkward spot for all Sky High. He was debating pretty heavily whether he wanted to play that Acolyte, but that would risk giving Fibonacci a natural way to actually burn a card from all Sky High. And in many matchups, burning a card isn't really that big of a deal, but in a matchup that both has individual key cards that are crucial to the effectiveness of both decks, things like Alexstrasza, but also the threat of going to fatigue. And here, speaking
here
of burning
go.
Cards,
see a card
deeper
burn again.
Cold Light Oracle.
Alexstrasza? And it could be big.
It just depends what comes off the top here. If he loses one of the critical cards to this particular matchup, Doomsayer are not a huge loss.
Actually, possibly happy he didn't have to draw that and just spend the mana playing out of his hand. The specific card choices from Fibonacci definitely showing their effectiveness here. That Coldlit Oracle helping burn through his opponent's cards and keep him even in the draw battle when it comes to fatigue.
Yeah, it's clear that Sky High doesn't have a room to be aggressive yet, but it still has the opportunity to get Alexstrasza on turn 9 to hit it, and that would be very big. So I'm still looking for one more turn for Sky High to flip this. Otherwise, sometimes you just play Maligos, and your opponent just has to double Fireball in order to answer, and then they're out of a lot of options. It depends on how Fibonacci also wants to navigate this.
Yeah, seeing the one Doomsayer lost, I mean, that's one of the really easy ways to attempt to answer Maligos. If that's not in play, this could get really awkward very quickly for Sky High.
Well, speaking of awkward, this Fibonacci doesn't have an incredible. Oh, he has a Flame Strike. Never mind. I actually just realized he was at 9. I thought he was at 8 mana. Yeah, Flame Strike. This is the best use you're going to get from Flame Strike in this matchup. All-Sky High did get a really good Emperor off, though, with some good discounts on a number of cheap spells.
Yes.
The most important spells, generally, to get discounted are your cheaper spells because they enable you to string together those combos because it's a higher percentage of their overall cost that ends up actually being being reduced. And most Freeze Mage decks do play Archmage Antonidas, so that reduced cost is a big deal in combination with the Archmage as well. We see All-Sky High just going to face here. He's firing off two fireballs, Fibonacci down to 15, and All-Sky High with that Pyroblast.
Yeah, but now that he's used his fireballs, he feels comfortable dropping Malygos, and now you have to Pyroblast it because it's such a threat, and you just lost 12 damage.
Yeah, and now All-Sky High, we see hit suddenly deep in thought. He was just sort of, oh, fireball your face, fireball your face. Oh, there's a dragon? Oh, no.
It made sense in context because he could pop the ice block next turn.
I think that it definitely did. But it suddenly puts him in a pretty rough position. And we saw Fibonacci, as soon as those fireballs were played, he just snapped off the dragon. Yeah. So
I want to imagine that Sky High was thinking about this in context of not giving Fibonacci an opportunity later on to use a defense of Alexstrasza. Mm-hmm. And at this point now, he's had to use a ton of those core critical spells to attempt to just stay in the game. It's going to be really hard for him to recover from that.
Now he can ping it purposefully. I mean, mm-hmm. there is a lot of room for Fibonacci to breathe here. He says, okay, you used 12 damage, 13 damage, in fact, and an Ice Lance Enabler. Sky High's last chance is to get Emperor Thorsen up, and Fibonacci's well aware, so he's going to make sure not to expend any resources to the point where he can't kill an Emperor
Archmage
Antonidas. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you, Gibbler. That's saving me once again from myself.
Yeah, Sky High really has to think very carefully here because he's much closer to fatigue, seeing things like the Arcane Intellect off the top. I mean, he wants to dig for options, but in some ways he can't afford to.
Yeah, and we're seeing how it feels like structurally advantaged Fibonacci's deck is here. And he talked during his interview before about how he feels like players will be able to find success if they, in many cases, just make those little changes based on the metagame that they expect. And I think Fibonacci came in expecting to see a lot of other Freeze Mage decks. And Freeze Mage versus Freeze Mage, I love his deck in the matchup.
Super
I hate the matchup. I may not like Freeze Mage as a deck, but as far as seeing a player rewarded for intelligent deck building and decision making, I'm super happy to see how this is going for Fibonacci.
He just wins the control mirrors. In Warrior vs. Warrior, he also doesn't lose either because he understands exactly what fatigue does. Mm-hmm. He can calculate the damage very meticulously. Fibonacci aware that he has to dump his hand. We're talking about Frost Novas and Blizzards sometimes on empty boards or Flame Strikes. This is one of those scenarios.
He doesn't want the Doomsayer to attack. It's so dangerous.
Mm. Yeah, stop right at its tracks.
He doesn't want it to bring his end.
Well,
interesting, right, to note that Sky High did such a smart job of teching his Reno Lock against Freeze Mage, but he really isn't as well equipped here for the mirror at all.
Well, the thing is, I think most people really think of Freeze Mage as kind of just a set deck. The thing of it is, oh, this is what Freeze Mage looks like. I'm going to play Freeze Mage. And that's sort of thinking I'm going to play Freeze Mage. This is, you know, Freeze Mage is good against, say, Paladin. I want to play it in this tournament. That's kind of like level two thinking. Level one thinking, I think, is, oh, Druid is good, Zoo is good, and Secret Paladin is good. I'm going to play those decks. Level two thinking is, oh, here's what's good against those decks. And Fibonacci actually appears to be on the level above that, which is, okay, I'm going to play the decks that are good against the decks I expect, and also make the decks good against people who I think are going to be trying to counter those decks as well.
Right.
So I'm really impressed by his lineup.
And then there's level four, where you could have played in the qualifier if you wanted to, but you decided to cast instead and let other people win for a chance.
I am just leveling everyone here.
Thank you, Kibler, for going to the level four.
All right, Fibonacci, he's just going to...
This is Freeze Mage Mirrors in a nutshell. Frostbolt, pass.
Just in case something comes Nova into pass. Play between the end of my turn and my opponent's turn, I don't want to attack.
There is inherent value of keeping a Blizzard because you can stall out minions like Alexstrasza from attacking you, and you do some damage to it because it has such high health.
And
so
Blizzard can also force your opponent to draw with Acolyte, which Frost Nova cannot.
And I assume Sky High at this point is just not going to play that Acolyte. He would never be in a position where would be viable.
He is sitting here with Acolyte and Arcane Intellect in his hand, and both of them are just actively bad.
You have to feel for him too, right? He hasn't had drawn his Archmage Antonidas, and that's the key card. Alexstrasza here is very weak. Either reduces his own life or heals his opponent. Can't really do it.
I mean, what he's looking to do is try to assemble enough damage to, eventually in fatigue get Fibonacci to exactly one. You know, we've seen the, we saw this kind of in the previous game, but he is so much closer to fatigue, I believe. I don't. I'd like to see if we can get an exact count on the players' decks remaining, but Fibonacci has only been drawing essentially with effects that cause both players to draw the two oracles. I think he did play Arcane Intellect as well.
A single Arcane Intellect,
but he's forced All Sky High to draw as well. So it's 6-4.
Pretty significant.
And but we do see that All Sky has so many more card draw effects just in his hand.
Right, and he's refusing to play it.
Mm-hmm. So, and All Sky just fires off that torch.
Do we know if Fibonacci has an Alexstrasza in his deck?
I'm fairly certain he's an Alexstrasza.
I would say that you have to have an Alexstrasza in the Frieze Mage deck. It's one of the core cards of really giving you a lot of range.
Actually, have we seen an Alexstrasza in his deck?
I would assume.
Well, we saw his entire deck last game.
Yeah.
I'm trying to remember if there's actually an Alexstrasza in that game.
Extremely
there was,
surprised.
Yes. There was. I'm fairly certain there was. There was not an Archmage Antonitus.
No.
Which is notable, because that is a very, very common card. In these decks, but yeah, yep. he certainly did play an Alexstrasza, but not an Archmage. So, speaking of Alexstrasza, it does come down for All Sky High on his turn, setting Fibonacci back down to 15.
Yeah, pretty surprising that Fibonacci was playing the Healbot very aggressively, because I do know that a lot of Frieze Mage players are on the school of thought that you should play the Healbot after your Ice Block gets popped. But perhaps he feels so confident that he'd rather just get this onto the board. Because Sky High's been passing so often, so he feels like he can. The reason why you would play Healbot after the Ice Block is because after they exhaust all their burn, they ping you to 1, and then you Healbot up to 9. They don't actually have the range to hit you anymore farther down, and that's usually a checkmate option.
That may be different, though, in this situation, because we are specifically dealing with the likelihood of fatigue damage being the end of the game.
True.
And Healbot may not be enough to actually recover to a point where he's safe from 2 turns of fatigue damage.
It does also give value to your opponent's Alexstrasza, but perhaps Fibonacci says, I'm not in range of popping his Ice Block anytime soon, therefore I'm going to play Healbot to give myself time, because I was at 9 health. I don't feel safe against Frostbolt Ice Lances, or even the Forgotten Torch, which happens to be what Sky High has right now. Which is also an interesting deck inclusion. Not only does he have 2 Fireballs, he also has 2 Forgotten Torches. So he's also not ill-equipped for the Frieze Mage Mirror. In fact, if he played other Frieze Mages that wasn't Fibonacci, I'm sure he had a distinct advantage with those Forgotten Torches. And yet he happens to go to the guy who went to the level beyond that. So Sky High was at level 2.5, Kibler, according to your measurements.
He's definitely
a complicated ranking system.
It is. But thankfully, Fibonacci, you know, he's a math student. He can figure it out.
Right. So. If Sky High had any way to trigger a freeze and use that Ice Lance, he could actually trigger the first Ice Block this turn, but he just doesn't have the damage potential to do it.
Let's see how much damage does both player have. Fibonacci has...
That's great. And Fibonacci just snaps that off. Emperor Tharsin coming down. A handful of cheap spells, including both Frostbolts, both Ice Lances, which, as we were mentioning earlier, in many cases, the most important cards to discount, because in this case, not their their combination with Antonitus, but Malagos, though that is now dead.
Also, he does have the second Ice Block reduced as well, which can be significant depending on what else he needs to do in any given turn.
I think Fibonacci might have played a little too quickly. He has exactly 20 damage of burn in his hand. And that's going to be really awkward for how he lines up his damage. And it's very exciting to think, oh, I play Emperor Thoris and this hand's really good. But you have to knock your opponent to 1 health and then use your hero power. So if you left him at 21, he'd be able to play it and then use it. Your opponent already used Alexstrasza. And you can't put him back up to 15. His only out at that point would be Healbot.
Do you think he just waits for fatigue, though? Do you think he's just at a point now where with only a couple of cards left in his opponent's deck, he's just going to hold that exact amount of burn, wait until fatigue is in play, and win, knowing he's got both Ice Blocks left?
Well, for Fibonacci, I mean, he doesn't have any healing in his hand now either. So we did just see All Sky High pick up that Frostbolt. He can threaten to actually set Fibonacci, though he does not, he's not choose to fire it off here. He could choose to set Fibonacci to, you know, very, very low low life heal himself. And oop, here we go. We are firing off all this burn now.
Yeah, that's right. Sky High is trying to keep his Thanos hidden so that he can go for this. However, this ends up being the scenario that we were talking about. He put him at 2.
Yeah.
And then, so he can't necessarily get through it exactly, but he's going to force his opponent to at least play Ice Block next turn.
Mm-hmm.
And Fibonacci's going to really hope that Sky High doesn't have any kind of heal or some way to answer this directly.
Yeah, I wonder if that play that you mentioned last turn may have worked out better for Fibonacci if he had pinged rather than playing the or rather had fired off all the burn rather than playing the Emperor, setting his opponent to that life total. We have seen the healing already, so but Allskyhigh does set up his second block. Mm-hmm.
But I mean, another thing of it too is that he could ping him to one, and then he'd be on fatigue. But he's two turns away from doing that,
right,
which ultimately is a slower play than doing it by pinging the hero power twice over two turns. It's a very small, nuanced thing, but it could have huge ramifications because if you lose this match, you're down 1-2, putting yourself to potentially lose the series.
Yeah, and he is in a position here where fatigue has been deferred slightly by the torch play. So we do know that there's going to be a little more time left before fatigue is a factor. Does Skyhigh trigger the first ice block this turn?
He doesn't want to play his Thanos because he realizes that he accelerates his fatigue. So his original plan to actually go for that was different. Now instead he's just going to use his Roaring Torch.
So he could have played Frostbolt Torch ping and set his opponent to one, right?
That's a pretty big deal.
Oh, yeah.
The fact that he can pop ice block number two. And now Skyhigh, I think, has to draw his Healbot if he has one. And otherwise that's game.
Yeah, I don't really see much in the way of options for Skyhigh here. It's kind of funny the Emperor just...
Whoa, was that a Healbot? Show me the Healbot! Oh,
no.
I saw a minion. Oh, my goodness. I apologize. Engineers.
And there is no Healbot.
There's no Healbot.
Yeah. That's it.
It makes sense given that he has the two forgotten torches, so he had to make cuts in different parts of his deck, but none more painful than that junk heap that he wants right now in his deck, and it's not there.
That's going to be game number three.
Yeah, after a long chess match of a game between Fibonacci and Allskyhigh here, Fibonacci does lead the series 2-1, and I generally do sort of rag on Freeze Mage decks, and Freeze Mage Mirrors in particular, but that was a really interesting game to watch.
That was an awesome game, Kibla. I really liked it. So, you know, put one in Freeze Mage's court for some of the most interesting games. It definitely showcased a lot of what you're talking about. Not only just the play execution of these players, a lot of chess matches, if you will, of I do this, I try to corner you, you try to escape from it. Also the deck building, which I really loved.
Yeah, to be fair, I was mostly excited because it involved a dragon. But
two dragons, actually.
Yeah.
Alexstrasza
and Maligos.
I guess a dragon that does something dragon-like rather than just sort of comboing people.
What? Actually, has a breeze on people and completely cuts their life in half.
But it's not, you know, yeah.
I appreciate where your excitement is coming from.
It has an awesome life and bleh.
It has an amazing animation. It is true.
That is true. I have to admit that's true.
Malagos has better voice acting. No questions asked.
It's true. That I can get behind. Malagos is pretty sweet.
Speaking of Malagos, we actually were going to talk earlier about Witty Bill. He was actually the player who he did advance in our last match that we saw. He was actually my opponent. For those of you who may have seen the Effigy Gone Wild video that actually Disguised Toast did the editing for me a while ago, where I got Aviana off of an effigy and played multiple Malagoses, whatever the plural of that word is, and then just blew up my own Ronin and just fired. Who knows, I can't count that high, arcane missiles at my opponent. He was actually also streaming at the same time. So there's a video of his side of it as he's just sort of chuckling as he's just getting blown up. So it was great to see him advance here as well.
Yeah, it was pretty awesome. It's like one of those final assaults that somebody shoots like a billion missiles. Usually the villain somehow survives a billion missile assaults in every movie. But in this case, Kibler was the hero, so he ended up winning. Should have played around it.
Looking at the video, I'm sort of cackling like a supervillain, so I don't know if I'm necessarily a hero in this instance.
Why do they ever work? It's always like the one nuke that works, but not like the million missiles. But in this case, if you haven't checked it out already, go to the YouTube and check out Kibler's video, The Effigy Gone Wild. Super entertaining. That could be the last time we see Malagos this series. Fibonacci is one win away with this Warlock deck remaining up against the Freeze Mage. And if it is that defensive Handlock deck, I wonder how it really responds to modern-day Freeze Mage. We don't see it that often because Handlock has been completely replaced by the Arena Warlock.
Yeah, we did see Fibonacci play early in the day, and he is playing the more sort of Handlock, Demonlock style of deck. He does have Mountain Giants. He's got duplicates of quite a few cards, so no Reno Jack. It has largely been supplanted, as you said, by Reno Warlock decks, generally speaking. But we actually There's an interview that we were able to get some information from Fibonacci, and he said that he doesn't necessarily think that this deck is better than a lot of the other versions, but he is so comfortable playing more controlling decks, this is what he decided to bring to the tournament.
And this is some of the only Warlock that we've seen tournament-wide that happens to be not Zoo. So I do think there's definitely some opportunity here for him to surprise a little bit with what he's able to do, because everybody's planning around that traditional board flood play.
Yeah, I believe we actually did see Witty Bell playing a similar sort of
kind of a demon handlock
style of deck. But yeah, I mean, there's one of the advantages of Warlock in general is that there are so many different iterations. This is funny.
That is the worst Dark Peddler I have ever seen.
Do you want the 1/2 ton?
Yep.
Well, the 1/2 doesn't die to the hero power, so.
A little more classical, you know, it's just a little. We're going to go a little bit retro here with the Goldshire Footman.
Alternatively, you also could have the least value card in the game, a Grimmskull Oracle. Independently, that does synergize with some of the Colette Oracles in other decks, but not in this scenario.
Also, so we do see the Faceless Manipulator drawn by Fibonacci. We actually saw him use that to great effect, copying his opponent's Ysera. In many cases, you see these Warlock decks typically using it as a finisher alongside something like Leroy or Kane Golem, but it can also just be a value card.
A little frustrating to be forced to play that first Voidcaller when the only thing it can draw out is the second Voidcaller, but there is going to be an opportunity here, I think, for Fibonacci to start and push a bit of damage. We know, looking at Sky High's hand, that he doesn't have the tools to really respond to the board just yet.
Yeah, I mean, Fibonacci doesn't have a great clock himself. Looks like he's going to go ahead, though, and make his board a lot more threatening with Emperor Tharason. That's a pretty strong hand to discount. If he is playing a combo with that Faceless, getting the Faceless discounted is extremely valuable in terms of increasing his burst damage potential on a lower number of mana crystals.
It's also going to bait out a ton of Sky High's single target removal, because he can't really afford to let his opponent get multiple turns of Tharason either.
Yeah, in general, but he's going to do it.
Wow.
So Fibonacci will get another turn of Tharason while Sky High gets one turn himself. I imagine we'll see that Tharason die.
Look at his hand. He has 2 Frost Bolts and 2 Ice Lances. He knows Reno Jackson does not exist. That's a lot of burst.
Yeah.
You can even do that on turn 10 all in one fell swoop with Alexstrasza, do 14 damage. Oh, I'm sorry, 29 damage if you add the context of Alexstrasza putting to 15. It's a lot. However, he would still be 1 damage short. So I can understand Sky High's reasoning. I have a lot of burn. I'm going to try to reduce his hand. I don't want to play off curve. I don't want to give up the burn.
These have been the least enjoyable Dark Peddlers for Fibonacci. You can see on his face when they come up, he just kind of goes, oh, that is not actually what I had in mind.
But this is a really good board for Fibonacci here. He gets to gets quite a bit of threat into play. Sky High really needs some sort of AoE to clear things, but doesn't have
it. It's not going to do it.
Sky High just has a bunch of spot removal that he really needs to use as burst damage to hope to win the game.
Yeah, this is a really high-level read from Fibonacci.
I actually expect what we'll see is Sky High just fire off Alexstrasza on Fibonacci next turn and just go for the burst kill the following turn.
I don't think he has any other choice in this matter.
There's Lotheb, though.
Yeah, but here's the thing. You don't want to play Lotheb into a turn your opponent plays Alexstrasza, and 8 mana is the soonest you
right,
do
and
it.
I don't think Fibonacci should play Lotheb this turn. I think that the Lotheb, though, gives him the ability to actually potentially beat that burst combo from all Sky High over the course of those turns, particularly if he's able to generate healing as well.
I completely agree. Second Void Caller is just more minion pressure. Sure, it doesn't get the value you want, but it still pulls Doomguard out, which is pretty good. It also increases your chances to 100% Doomguard gets pulled in the event that you actually need it on board.
Well, this is an interesting draw from All Sky High here. He does find the Doomsayer. So now, instead of just maybe I'm going to try and Alexstrasza blow you up over the course of 2 turns, he has the option to use the Frost Nova Doomsayer. I think if he hadn't drawn Doomsayer there, I think that there's really not much that he could have done other than just kind of hope.
His hand
is just, you know, that's all it does is sort of this burst kill. And we're going to see it anyway, though. Alexstrasza sets Fibonacci to 15. And this is a precarious point now in the game, because if Fibonacci...
Oh my God.
Huge see, draw.
Wow.
Oh, dear. That is enormous.
That was such a big deal because Mal'Ganis makes your hero immune, therefore you can't even target it anymore.
He can face, if he wants, he can faceless Mal'Ganis and Lotheb this turn.
Oh my
This is absurd.
Wait, no.
Oh, but look at this turn. Look at what's happening.
No, how do you respond to this?
What just happened? And he can low them him too if he wants. He doesn't.
Yeah, there's no reason not to.
My God, that turn from Fibonacci.
Does that mean that he's vulnerable to a Frost Nova Doomsayer?
He can't Frost Nova Doomsayer.
He can. He can just Frost Nova Doomsayer.
He has a discount.
He just
has it. Oh my God. The discount actually is all.
This game is absolute turn
backwards. That was
backwards. Outrageous.
I mean, there's nothing he can do.
Is he actually dead now?
No, he can.
He'd have to dark bomb his own guy to heal himself to not die to this burst combo. This game has been just crazy back and forth.
Oh, Shadow Flame.
He can Shadow Flame him out Ganis.
He can Shadow Flame any of his things, really.
Yeah.
Like the Doom Guard.
Get rid of the Lotheb.
Oh my God!
Hey.
Look at it, the Reliquary Seeker, the value.
Hey, you were doubting it. He says, you know what? Just in case I draw out.
Oh, he chooses not to. He chooses not to
play.
He wants to hold that space for the
Heal. I think it's right, but it would be way more hilarious to me if he actually got value off that Seeker.
He still can. Next turn, he still can. Don't
worry. He can. It's true.
He can play Healbot and the Reliquary Seeker. The Thanos does activate the Mortal Coil as well, but this is all of Sky High's hand, and Fibonacci. Despite having a couple of rocky moments this series, looks like he is in a firm position to win this
game.
It's the best board we've seen all weekend.
But then we just saw two Mal'Ganises die in the same turn. It's so sad.
But that was 18 health that he had to go through, right?
How can Mal'Ganis be eternal if two of them die in one turn?
I'm eternal for this turn.
I am one
temporarily
turn is apparently
eternal.
What his ability actually is. He's just mispronouncing it.
Mm.
Wow, this game has been nuts.
And I think at this point, Sky High is out of options. He's used all his burn. He's seen Alexstrasza come and go.
Well, Arcane Intellect, if something's going to get him back into that game, that's where it's going to start. But yeah, he can Frost Nova to buy himself some
a
more
turn,
time,
stalls
play down
a little
this Acolyte of Pain.
Yes.
Still though, Fibonacci now with a huge board that All Sky High has no answers to.
He also has the burn to pop the ice block.
Yeah, we can actually. Oh, he was debating dark bombing that. I think we may see Hellfire to dark bomb you though. Maybe not though.
He could feel like he gives up too much of his board.
Yeah, it could be dangerous here. He may just not feel like that's worthwhile.
Okay.
And he does go ahead and get value off of that Reliquary Seeker. Not so bad a Dark Peddler after all.
Yeah, that one worked out pretty
okay. Made him a 5/5.
A 0 mana 5/5 because of Emperor Thorsan. Acolyte's going to try to dig a little bit deeper, but no more Frost Novas for Sky High. Is he looking at his last couple of turns in the winner's bracket here? I mean, I don't really see a way for him to stop the ice block getting popped. He still has at least two more guaranteed turns, though.
And Fibonacci, with no way to play minions here, he's going to pop that block and ultimately just have to wait and see what the next turn looks like here. He can't really control this situation any more than that.
Yeah, he looks like he's going to go ahead. Yeah, he's trading in to make some more room. Going to clear out this mad scientist. He doesn't want All Sky High to get another secret. We know that second copy of Ice Block is in the hand, but it's still a heads-up play from Fibonacci here.
Yeah, the only thing that I... Oh, okay, because he has Hellfire. Okay, never mind. I was saying the only thing I don't like is that it's weak to the Frost, not the Frost, but the Blizzard and the Doomsayer. But if you do that, then
you can't play Ice
Block.
You can't really play Ice Block.
So it's a very nice corner move. And so now Sky High has to debate: do I have any options, or do I Forgotten Torch my own hero?
Well, it looks like he can survive a turn. He's got an Ice Block, but I don't really see a road to actually winning this game. Okay. Fibonacci is still at 25. All Sky High with not very many resources at all after he burned so much killing the Mal'Ganis.
Let's think, though. let's assume Fibonacci doesn't have any burn. His best play might to play Ice Block and then toss some burn, and then subsequent turns draw into Pyroblast, or maybe Pyroblast's last card, draw into some kind of way to stall the board, burn, like Arcane Intellect, Frostbolt, or whatever else is remaining in the deck, and then get Pyroblast as his last. That could be Sky High's last chance in his mind.
With three turns, he could potentially draw sufficient burn to actually do it.
Yeah, he can Blizzard, and then...
Oh, well, that's it. The Blizzard means that he has no more Ice Block. Fibonacci is our second player to go to the Winter Championships.
Yeah, this Hellfire is going to finish things off. Or Jiraxxus, finish it in
style. Style points.
No style points. Oh.
There cold, hard mathematics.
That's a two from the Russian judge. But
all right. Well, Fibonacci, as you said, will be our second competitor joining. I actually just blanked.
Joining Witty Bill.
We were just talking about it earlier.
Bill. Joining him in the Winter Championships.
Too many freeze mage games. Yeah, making my mind melt.
It's been too long since we've seen a player like this who has been given so much hype by other players to finally succeed and come to his own. Fibonacci has been hyped by many players as one of the best control players, if not the best control player on the ranked servers of America. For a long time, he actually didn't even want to stream because he's not that type of player that wants to get into the public light. He's very shy. He's very timid, but his play speaks much larger volumes than maybe his words are. This guy is an absolute monster. I can't believe that it took him this long to qualify, but I'm really happy he did.
Yeah, his sort of prelude kind of reminds me of Firebat, actually. Firebat was a player who didn't really get a ton of hype from the wider audience, but competitive players, they thought incredibly highly of him, and he went on to win the World Championship just 2 years ago. So we could perhaps see big things from Fibonacci as well.
1.5 years ago, kid, but it's not
two calendar years ago.
Too much distance between him and the championship. Kevin, you wanted to say something.
I was just going to say, I think we did really see from Fibonacci just exactly how carefully he teched those decks. Every deck he brought to this tournament had a little something special that gave him a really meaningful edge in every one of those games.
Absolutely. And you know what's really funny too is that you mentioned that many people weren't really hyped to see Fibonacci as much as some of these players like Strife Crow and Tides of Time, for example, who have unfortunately been eliminated. But at the same time, the public has seen his name appear so often in the Blizzard vlogs of him hitting number one. They say, who is this guy? We need to know, because everyone knows that he's playing Control Warrior in a meta game where everyone is gunning for like Control Warrior because they have decks that are very good against it. The Druid's very good against it. The Paladin is super effective. Even the Zoo Warlock sometimes builds a very decisive board, and it's hard for Warrior to fight off against it, but not for someone like Fibonacci, who techs his deck with Death Lords and Doomsayers and Brawls. And you know, the Jewel Scarab is so surprising. We were underestimating that card a lot and ended up being pretty valuable.
Yeah, I mean, it feels like Fibonacci is kind of like the mysterious challenger, except everyone likes him.
And with that, I couldn't have ended it any better way. We are done here on the desk for our second match. TJ is waiting to have a few words with Fibonacci and wrap up our series here.
Thank you very much, Dan. Yeah, that was a really exciting match. Some of you may not think so with the Freeze Mage versus Freeze Mage mirrors, but those matchups are super intricate. It's cool to see Fibonacci go through. He had a rough time in the America's Championship qualifier last year, but it's good to see him, you know, make that comeback and qualify for the America's Championship. But I am standing by with Fibonacci, who's going to give us a few words. Fibonacci, can you hear me?
Yes, I do. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can. First off, big congratulations. How does it feel to move on to the America's Championship for the winter season after what I'm sure was a disappointing run throughout the America's qualifier last year?
It feels great. I got to play my Warrior for the first time today, so I feel great today.
So did you get to play the Warrior at all in your matches yesterday?
No. Only today. Only once.
Okay. Yeah. Well, talk to me a little bit about that Warrior deck. What goes into the preparation for teching and building your famed Warrior decks?
My Warrior deck is right now aimed at the Zoo and Paladin, which are popular on ladder. So whenever you build the Warrior right now, so you have to build it as an anti-aggro. Otherwise, you are going to lose to Zoo or Secret Paladin without the double ball or double range. So you need all AoE to have a chance, to stand a chance against those decks. So if you play like a standard deck that was one ball, like no revenge, I don't think you can climb ladder.
Well, it seemed to work out super well for you this time around since you did make it through. Was there any practice partners or teams or players that you prepped with for this tournament?
Yeah, I practiced with Tide of Time and New Ability.
Okay, well, it seems like his name's getting around a lot. He's one of the players that a lot of people are practicing with. But once again, Fibonacci, a big congratulations. Look forward to seeing you at the America's Championship.
Thank you.
Thank you. And we still have some updates from around the rest of the winter preliminary for the Americas. Al Sky High, he's not out of the tournament yet. He'll go down to the lowest bracket, and he'll face off against That's Admirable. So keep an eye out for that match later. Of course, we still have Nostum, who we saw earlier. He's going to be going up against one of the Tavern Hero winners, Snail, later on. And the next match that we have coming up on stream is going to be Kit Kats versus ChessDude123. Also, make sure you're staying engaged on social media throughout the day. You can use the hashtag HCT, tweet at PlayHearthstone, or of course any of the other casters' personal Twitters. Let us know who you're rooting for throughout the day. There's not that many players left, some known names, some unknown names. So get on that social media and keep engaged in that conversation. But we are going to have to go to a quick break before we jump into Kit Kats versus ChessDude. Don't go anywhere. More Hearthstone Championship Tour action continues right after this.